Welcome to Capital Mind Tube. This is Deepak Shenoy. I'm going to take you today through a concept we're looking at about why interest rates aren't look likely to fall. We've made a premium post about that, but here's a quick video on what the RBI is saying. Effectively, RBI is saying that inflation is less important than growth. And you're going to see why they're saying it and why they're likely to keep interest rates low for at least a year or so from now. Let's look at the policy that they released in the recent past, and that's something that they said last Friday. They said, we're going to keep the policy rate unchanged at 4%. Now, this is the lowest policy rate has been for a long time, so not reducing it further was one of the things that they've done. But also, they've said they're going to continue with the accommodative stance as long as necessary, at least during the current financial year and into the next, which means they want to revive growth on a durable basis, which means they're saying, listen, we want to ensure that inflation remains within the target, but we are going to focus on growth. So what are they really saying? The global economy is overcast with COVID infections. There's a lot of vaccine candidates. We all know that stuff. But also in the domestic economy, they are talking about the fact that we've had a contraction of 7.5% in real GDP. Again, something we know now is possibly temporary. We're talking about recovery gaining traction. We're talking about growth in passenger vehicles and motorcycle sales, electricity consumption. And there was some, it is a favorable monsoon. Rabi sowing is up 4%. Now, remember, we have farmers, protestants, all that stuff. But Rabi sowing is up 4%. So this will eventually show up in cereal prices, looking at where, when the harvest happens, I think early January to February. Inflation was up to 7.3 and then 7.6. Of course, inflation for December hasn't yet come. It'll come in a few days, but with some evidence, they say that the price pressures are spreading. And the reason for that is that protein-rich items like pulses and edibles, oils, and vegetables and all that stuff is quite high, and core inflation is also up to from 5.4 to 5.8. Now, this is not a huge amount, but it's a slight increase, and that's something that's worrying. Inflation remains quite high in from that. So if you look at what they did on a financial conditions, they actually increased the reserve money, which is what they print and they add to the economy, by 15% in 1 year. And they've been printing a lot of money. They've talked about how non-food growth accelerated and moved into positive territory. He says basically, listen, the government was getting most of the money that I was printing. Instead of that, which is this is how you decode it, right? Large inflow of deposits into the banking system was predominantly deployed in SLR investments, which means banks were taking the money that was being printed by the RBI and then effectively deploying it into government bonds in a way. Now they're giving it to corporate credit because bond issuances have gone up. We've got higher foreign exchange reserves by about, $20 odd billion in a month from October 2 to December, so about 2 months. We're talking of the outlook for inflation turning relatively high. When I say outlook, I mean what was inflation was the past, and what the outlook is the future. And this is something he says that there is a wedge between wholesale and retail inflation. Wholesale is low and retail is high. This, he says, they might soften a little bit with bumper kharif harvest arrivals. Kharif is the summer crop. Rabi is the winter crop. The vegetable prices may ease with the winter crop because winter is when the vegetables come into the market. This usually happens December, January onwards. Crude oil prices also have picked up. So they expect cost pressures to go up. Having said that, what they're saying really is that inflation is likely to increase from here. So where we are right now is at the 7.3 levels. We don't have inflation for this period because data collection was low. So he says inflation might actually go up in Q4 to even closer to 8 and then is likely to come down from there down to 6. I'm looking at the upper end of this dark red bar, which is the 50% confidence interval. Basically, they are saying, listen, we're sort of, like, if you look at the upper end of this, the range at which we're comfortable at, we're talking 6 to 7% by next Q1 2021-22, that's or Q2 2022, which is about, say, July to September 21. This actually means that we should see inflation moderating into next year, but we are at least likely to see inflation go up. The quarterly growth production projection is also, you know, because we went minus 23, we'll go plus 24 and so on. So we'll come down to back to closer to 8% in next year is what they're saying, which is fine. I mean, because there's lots of one-offs over here. What is interesting is he says inflation is likely to remain elevated and the signs of recovery are far from being broad-based and are dependent on policy supporters. Essentially means whatever you do, you're going to need the RBI to help you. A small window is available, they say, for the inflation to be targeted better. But the RBI remains key. They say they will continue with the accommodative stance as long as necessary into at least a year ahead. Everybody voted on this one unanimously that keep rates down, and keep rates down not just now, but keep the accommodative stance ready for the next year. It says into the next financial year, which is probably first two quarters of the next financial year. So they're giving you about a year outlook from here to say that rates are going to not go up effectively, or the RBI is going to keep printing money. Interestingly, they talk about interest rate expectations from the household inflation expectation survey, and that is down because you're looking at something where they're saying actual inflation, what people perceive, is down 1% from what they saw, because what people think is inflation is very different from what actually inflation is, right? So people think it's 9.8, that's what they're thinking. But if they think inflation's come down, that come down to 8.8, it's just lower than last time. So it's almost like you look at their trends, not the actual number. Both their inflation expectations, which have marginally come down, and their inflation feeling of how much inflation is currently, both have moderated. So this is actually a good thing, because the inflation and 1 year ahead expectations form an idea of what people are thinking of the economy rather than what the RBI is getting from the actual underlying data. This is interesting, but it's very small. The differential is very small. So they do have a room that says, okay, eventually likely prices will come down. What is also interesting is their development policies. We talked about a bunch of them earlier. But if we look at what they did in the statement of development and regulatory policies, they have said, now here's where I talk about stress, right? So markets generally to look at are very buoyant. They're saying, oh, everything's fine, everything will recover fine. But RBI is telling you a different story. They're saying, listen, growth is under stress. That's why I'm giving you an accommodative policy, because I'm not seeing growth in reality. We are seeing they want to introduce on-tap TLTRO. Essentially what it means is, listen, there are people who need money, companies that need money. And this is when the banks themselves are not willing to give their money or source their money from a cheap background. So RBI gives money at a relatively cheap rate. Right now it's about 3.35% to banks using this TLTRO scheme. Where do you find that? You look at rbi.org.in. Let's go into press releases and then look at the money market operation. This comes on a daily basis. You can see over here the TLTRO is targeted long-term repo operations. You can see over here that there was 12,000 crores. This was at 4.4. All of these rates were 4.4%. Any new targeted TLTRO will be at 4% in all probability. This is a bid rate. So, I mean, this was a fixed rate earlier. Now, I think they might introduce a bid rate as well. So, what it actually means here is that you can actually do a bunch of stuff. There's something called an on-tap TLTRO. Earlier it was being announced TLTRO, saying, okay, I'm going to give this 1 lakh crores. People bid whenever, and whoever bids in, I'll give you this money at 4.4, whatever percentage. Now they're saying there are 26 stress sectors. This was identified by a Kamath committee. We'll come to that later. These are, they're saying, listen, go to you banks, if you're lending to these stress sectors, you can borrow money from the RBI at this relatively low rate whenever you want. It's on tap. And deliver this to those companies by buying their bonds or giving them loans or however. And you will be actually able to use these two new sectors. We'll be adding the healthcare sector with credit between 50 and 500 crores, additional to the 26 stress sectors that the Kamath Committee had recommended. And I haven't gone to the Kamath Committee yet, but that's actually got a ton of things like power, real estate, infrastructure. All these are stressed sectors due to COVID itself. And that's going to get funds at a lower rate. It actually tells you one thing. RBI actually thinks a lot of sectors are so stressed that banks are unwilling to give them money. So it's reducing the cost for the banks if it on-lends to these sectors. Let's also look at another part where the banks of Indian scheduled commercial banks are not allowed anymore to give dividends for last year. That means they're saying in view of the ongoing stress and heightened uncertainty, it's imperative that banks continue to conserve capital and absorb losses. They're expecting losses to come, and therefore they're telling the banks, don't give out your capital as dividend. Keep it there because you're going to need this capital in order to keep us keep your balance sheet strong enough to support losses. What happens when you have losses is you have to assign, allocate part of your capital. So if a loan of 100 crores goes bad, the first thing you're going to do is put 15 crores out of your capital saying, oh, loan has gone bad, 15 crores out of the 100, 15% needs to be assigned. So if you give away your capital as dividend, you don't have that buffer to be able to use this. So they don't want you. So essentially what the RBI is telling you is don't give out dividends because there's stress coming and you're going to need that capital. They're telling us that banks are going to need capital to support losses. What they're telling us is things aren't as good as stock markets make them out to be. There are other things over here. For instance, there's some scale regulatory concept for NBFCs, strengthening audit. I won't go into too much of that detail. But essentially, we look at that for a guidance. There's a bunch of other things over here where they're talking about they'll review a lot of the money market directions and so on. What is interesting also over here is that they want to promote exports. So if you send out, for instance, shrimp or any perishable product, and earlier you had to approach the Reserve Bank for an approval if there was a return in this. So the idea being that, here you go. It's actually import refunds of export proceeds. So the idea was if you had poor quality of the goods exported, you were allowed to refund the money only if the export products were re-imported. Now it's allowed, it's been decided, oh dude, you can't re-import shrimp because they will take that shrimp and say it's bad, or potatoes or whatever it is that you're importing that's perishable, and they'll destroy it. They won't send it back to India. But the Indian importer is not allowed to remit the money back if the goods aren't re-imported. What they have said is, listen, fine, you know, if they destroy the goods and you have proof of destruction, then please refund them. This is a small, part of the system. The policy is quite interesting because essentially what they have done, I mean, this is a small policy change. They have said contactless, those little Wi-Fi symbol you see on some credit cards, which they can just flash, no PIN required. The limit has been increased from 2,000 to 5,000. That's a small area. What this actually tells us is that the policy actually tells us that there is a huge difference between what we are seeing with respect to the stock market and the economy. Now, I'm going to go through a little bit of something that we did here with respect to what has happened in the past. Now, we've had very low interest rates in the past. The yellow orange line is the interest rates, which is the RBI report. It's on the right-hand axis. It also went very low in 2008-2009. And then the difference between the one-year bond and the 10-year bond actually went up quite substantially. The one-year bond was very low. The 10-year bond was very high. RBI repo rates were at that time 4.75. That time the spread between the 10-year and the one-year, which is we call the spread, in terms of bips is basis points, which is 100 basis points is 1%. So 0.01 basis point is 1 bip. 300 basis points is 3%. Right now, the difference between the 1 year and the 10 year is more than nearly 2.5%. That's 250 basis points. This is one of the highest it's been in the last 10 or 11 years. And we've seen that this typically tends to come down only when interest rates go up. But if interest rates remain low, this spread is unlikely to go up much more. So if it remains low, it's likely to stay around these levels. Which is why we feel that, longer term bond funds will make a lot better sense to invest in compared to shorter term funds. What this also means to you is that liquid funds are going to give almost no returns. Your fixed deposits are going to give no returns. Why FDs will hurt you tremendously is because of this simple concept. There's no way that you can get great returns from liquid fund, or even an ultra short term fund, or anything that matures and expires in the next 2 or 3 years, simply because there's no way those things can give any great amount of money, because there's so much money sloshing around. Look at the same Reserve Bank of India thing that we're talking about. The amount of extra money with banks is 6.7 lakh crores. So 677,259 crores is being deposited with the RBI every day. That's how much the RBI has printed extra in order to support the economy. And where does that go? So if you look at FTRAC, and I'll just quickly run you through this, you're seeing a lot of people being able to issue bonds, and I'll take you through this exact point where they are. One of them is it's not yet coming, but okay, here you go. So what we're seeing over here is that there's a bunch of people who are issuing bonds, and look at the traded yields of these bonds. These bonds are trading at yields of 3.46, 3.15, and 3.72%, which is actually quite amazing, because if you think about it, even the new bonds, those are traded bonds in the secondary market, the new bonds that are coming in, NTPC is issued 90-day paper at 3.07%. This is why your liquid funds will return so little, because if NTPC is able to issue 90-day bonds for 3.07 and liquid funds has a expense ratio of maybe 0.1 or 0.2%, you will get less than 3% eventually when you invest in one of these index funds. Only one, maybe JM Financial Services, is at 180-day paper is going to 5.7%. 180-day paper anyway doesn't belong in liquid funds. But assuming that you are able to look at an ultra short term fund, that's the riskiest bond is GM Financials in this context. Tata Motors Finance, which is issued a 91-day commercial paper, is 3.45, and the stress will be in areas like a trust investment advisors, which is probably relatively less known. Even an EID Parry is issuing at 3.53. You can look at a bond matrix that you can see on CCIL India, and that will actually tell you how the government bonds are doing. We'll just take a look at this. The government bonds for 2030, which is the most popular bond, is 5.91%. This is 10 years ahead. So that's obviously at a much higher rate. So you saw the short term, 3.3%. The long term is 5.91. So effectively, you're talking of a risky short term. NTPC is definitely more risky than the government. Risky short term is at 3.07, and non-risky long-term is 5.91. So the difference between 3 month and 10 year is a huge amount. Now, if you look at, there's something called an NDSOM, and we're going to quickly take a look at this for the T-bills. This is the government 3 month bonds. Okay, something that's ending in, say, 3-2021, 11-3-2021. Is trading at, again, 3.08, 3.09. So the difference between short-term risky like NTPC versus short-term government is not very much. But long-term, of course, they are trading at higher values. We won't go into that. Specifically, if you look at this yield curve, this spread, which is 3 and 5.91, is 291 basis points, 2.91%. That is likely to contract. Now, it could contract in two ways. The short term could go up and the long term could remain the same, or the short term could remain the same and the long term could come down. Both ways, it's better to be with the long term. You want to be where the yields are either coming down or staying constant. There is a small possibility that both move up and then contract together, and that will happen if RBI increases interest rates. But like we've seen, RBI is not increasing interest rates. So the next 6 or 7 months, I don't think the spread widens. As it is, it might just come down because more and more money is being printed. There's no money in the short term. Everybody's going to rush to the long term. So long term bonds, longer term mutual funds is probably where it is. Given the fact that the RBI has set so much of stress in the economy, we are more likely to want to be with safer credit, not with more expensive, not with more corporate credit, more so government, more bank, more PSU credit, rather than more private corporate credit, because there may be stress in those sectors. That's the reason why RBI is saying the recovery is under threat. So here we are, ladies and gentlemen. I think I'll just take you to back to this. This is Capital Mind Tube for you. We're talking about why interest rates are likely to have to remain low, and therefore your FDs, your short-term fund and illiquid fund returns are likely to be in threat. So right now, we've talked about in Capital Mind Premium, and we've even changed our Capital Mind Premium fixed income portfolios to reflect this. But this is just something that, you know, we're getting this signal from the RBI. So watch out, make your portfolio plans accordingly. Cheers.